time, he's not challenging people. He didn't begin with the challenge to produce a surah.
That's not how the da'wah began. And after 10 years of calling people to justice, calling people to tawheed, calling people to be grateful and not to kill their baby daughters and not to cheat people in business and not to push the orphan around, this is what Makki Quran is full of. And to believe that you'll be resurrected, that you've been created for a purpose, these were the things Allah's Messenger calls towards in Makki Quran. And after 10 years of not listening, when they have no arguments after this and they're still rejecting the message, as a final resort, you know what? If you really think this is the word of an insane person, or this is magic, this is something other than the word of Allah, because they came up with all these other explanations, right? He copied it from the Christians and Jews, he's insane, ma'adallah, he's a liar, he's making this up, he's plagiarizing it, you know, these are old stories he's learning, etc. All these theories they came out with, in the end, the final verdict of Allah is, you know what? If you really think that's the case, how about this? How about you produce a surah like this one? Now you have to understand what that means. The first point I want to make is da'wah does not begin with this, da'wah ends with this. For a lot of us nowadays, you know what happens? Our da'wah doesn't end with this, it begins with this. So you know you have like this Islam Awareness Week at some college, and these young Muslim students have these pamphlets out about the miracles of the Quran and things like that. And some random guy walks by and says, hey, that's interesting, what's this, Islam? And the guy, you know, young brother is a little overzealous in giving da'wah. Hey, you know, you're not Muslim, why don't you produce a surah? The guy's like, what's a surah, man? What you talking about? I just saw the sign for free food, so I came, but I don't know what a surah is. And then even if somebody's interested in Islam and they say, I'm not so convinced, you say, oh yeah, if you're not convinced, bring a surah like it. Look, the Quran says produce a surah. No, that's not how da'wah works. That's not what Allah is saying. This was said to a group of people that were adamant, that were completely obnoxious, and they had exhibited no more interest after the best da'wah was given to them, not once or twice, for over a decade. Now you know what? Go ahead, bring your own surah. Bring your own surah. But then I want you to appreciate at least why the Quraysh are stumped, and why the people, you know, the people of the book also, they're stumped. They have no idea how to come up with a surah. They don't know. By the way, in 1998, I think it was, Georgetown University published a surah. A group of students that were PhD students, and they call it Islamic studies program, it's really un-Islamic studies, right? They have this program, and the Arabic program, and as a class project, they made a surah. And they put it up back on the day of GeoCities, right? So we got a surah. It was called Suratul Muslim, they named it. And it's got the Uthmani script, and it rhymes and stuff. And if you don't know Arabic, you read it like, oh my God, they done did it, you know? But you'd be surprised. It's idiotic, these attempts. They're laughable, these attempts. Now, I'll just give you a clue of what Allah says when he says produce a surah like it. You see, like, let me give you the example of Tufail ibn Amr ad-Dawsi. Tufail was the leader of his tribe. He didn't live in Mecca. He was from another tribe. He had heard about this messenger in Mecca, but he didn't know anything more. He just knew there's a guy, he's claiming to be a messenger, people have started believing in him, it's causing a lot of trouble, I heard. Now, his tribe also had idols in Mecca, so if they want to do Hajj, from any tribe in Arabia, they come to Mecca. So he's coming to Mecca, and he's the leader of his tribe, so the Quraysh came out at the outskirts, the exits of Mecca. They stopped him there, they said, Tufail, you're an important person, don't come to Mecca nowadays. There's a man in there, he's got magic in his words. We don't want you to get infected. We don't want you to get influenced because you're important. You're an important person. You're important to your people. It's better you leave this time. Just come back later on. Because they didn't want him to come in contact with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, he says, you know, first he thought maybe I should just go. He said, no, I came all this way. At least let me pay the visit to Allah's house and then I'll go. They said, fine, if you want to come so badly, here's some cork, plug your ears. If you see this man, they described the Rasulullah, if you see him, if you hear those words, you'll know those words. They're very powerful. What you do is you put this cork in your ears and you run. So he takes the cork from them and he goes into Mecca. And he sees the Messenger, when he goes to the Haram, he sees the Messenger reciting Quran. He hears a little bit of it, he says, this has got to be it. So he plugs his ears and he starts making a run for it. And halfway making a dash, he stops himself and he says, why do I have to run? I am the leader of my tribe. I am one of the best poets in Arabia. I'm the master of language. I don't have to run from these words. So he unplugs his ears. And he comes back to listen to Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he takes shahada and then narrates the story himself. They knew the power of this Qur'an, that one of the worst enemies of Islam, Utbah ibn Rabi'ah, worst enemies of Islam. This was like, if this guy was alive today, he would be a commentator on Fox. Right? This is what this guy is. He was the expert debater. His job is not just to debate people, but to humiliate them when he debates with them. When they couldn't come up with any answers for this Qur'an, they told Utbah, why don't you go debate with Muhammad? They don't say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we do, right? Why don't you go debate with him? We're tired of this. You're the guy, we think you can handle him. We'll watch from a distance. So they're watching like a stadium game from a distance, what's going to happen between him and Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He comes to the Messenger of Allah, very insulting. He comes and starts barking like a dog. What do you want? You want women? You want property? You want leadership? You want money? What is it that you want? I'm here to take any of your demands. And he's going on like this in such a indignified fashion to the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, and the Messenger is listening very patiently. He's listening. And at the end of his barking, he said, أَفَرَغْتَ أَبَا الْوَلِيدِ? You done? The father of Walid? Are you finished? Can I start now? And he says, yes, go ahead. So the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, starts reciting from Surah Fussilat. And when he starts reciting, Utbah, their pit bull, their bulldog, starts crying. And he starts crying and he starts trying to grab the mouth of Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no more. He can't take any more of Qur'an. And then when the Messenger finished reciting sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he went into sajda, and he came back to the Quraysh are watching from a distance, they don't know what's going on. When he comes back, they say to him, your face is not the face you left with, this is some other face, what happened to you? It's like your face got rearranged. He says, I don't know what that is, it's not magic, but I know something, it's going to be a huge thing. سَيَكُونُ نَبَأً عَظِيمًا. It's going to be a huge event. Whatever that man has to say is going to happen. That's going to happen. And they said, oh, he got you too, Saharak. He did magic to you too. And he said, say what you will, I'm not messing with him anymore. He walked away. He couldn't take it. So when Allah says, bring a surah like it, why don't you bring someone that stumps the best of you like this Qur'an does? That you have no response to whatsoever. And finally, I tell you in this last minute, one of the last accusations against the Qur'an was that it's magic. This is one of the final accusations in the series of first it was he's insane, then he's a liar, then this and that and the other. And one of the last ones was, it is magic. It was the universal press release from Quraysh. Everybody should just call it magic. Now you tell me, is magic something you hear or magic something you see? Magic is something amazing that you see. You know, some guy is floating in the air, you call it magic. You know, the water parts, you might call that magic. A staff turns into snake, you might call that magic. But the Messenger is not producing any trickery. All he has is what? Words. But these words have such an impact on the one listening to it, they say these words must have magic in them. In other words, by calling it magic, they already acknowledge the overwhelming power of the Qur'an. Now think about that. You and I are going to stand in salah right now and listen to Allah's word. We're going to listen to the words that the enemies of Islam, those who hated Allah's Messenger, when they heard it, they would start crying. When they heard it, they would be overwhelmed. When they heard it, they would say, this got magical power. And yet here we are standing and we're wondering, man, when is ruku' coming? SubhanAllah. May Allah give us khushu' in salah and give us the ability to enjoy each and every ayah that is recited. And may Allah grant all of us acceptance in every one of our prayers. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.